Joining us now to tackle this issue, as well as the human rights record of the Marcos administration, is Elaine Pearson. She is the director of the Asia Division of Human Rights Watch. Elaine, good afternoon to you. Thanks for joining us today, and welcome to the program.
Thanks very much for having me on.
All right, Elaine, I'm going to start off with this question. You are here at a time when the ICC had just rejected the appeal to suspend the investigation into the Duterte administration's bloody drug war, while the appeal itself to stop the investigation in total is still pending. What do you make of this latest development, Elaine?
Well, I mean, I think the ICC is proving that, you know, it will investigate the very worst atrocities that have been committed here in the Philippines. It is a court of last resort, and the Philippines was a signatory to the Rome Statute, and that means the Philippine government has an obligation to cooperate with the court for the abuses that took place during the time that it was a member of the court. And so I think for the Marcos government to now say that they're just simply going to disengage with the court is really the wrong approach. I think the Marcos government should actually be extending its support to the court, inviting investigators here. But instead, we're seeing, you know, all of these statements really trying to sort of shut down the ICC's jurisdiction, which simply you can't do. I mean, the investigation has been opened, it's underway, and, you know, clearly the prosecutor has said that they will continue this investigation. We'll wait to see what happens with the appeal.
But the fact, though, that the Philippine government, in the beginning, really engaged with the ICC and used the mechanisms available to all the member states. In this case, government is actually contesting that as well. But the fact that that happened, what does that tell you?
Well, I mean, they should be engaging with the ICC, but, you know, really what the Philippine government should be doing is they should be investigating and prosecuting the thousands of killings that have happened in the war on drugs. And, you know, that simply hasn't happened. Of the thousands of killings, we've only seen two convictions of a handful of lower level perpetrators. Mm. So I think, you know, what we're really looking to see is that there is some genuine accountability for the abuse that took place in the war on drugs. I mean, these are crimes against humanity. In my time here in the Philippines, I've met with widows who've shared heartbreaking stories of how they'd had to collect the bodies of loved ones riddled with bullets. And there's been no accountability for these killings. So, you know, I think, you know, there is justice that is really owed to the victims, to the families, and that, you know, the Philippine government should be saying, we're going to cooperate with the court. And this is a court of last resort, but it is investigating precisely because of the Philippines government's failure to conduct those investigations and prosecutions itself.
Well, Elaine, glad you brought that up, because a couple of days back, actually, I think it was just yesterday, when I was able to speak with the Solicitor General of the Republic himself, Menardo Guevara, and I asked him that question. If there are 6,000 plus cases as official count of the Philippine National Police, why aren't there 6,000 plus cases being investigated by the Justice Department, even during his time as Justice Secretary? And this is what he said. To paraphrase him, he says that most of these victims' families do not participate in these cases. He says there's non-participation, they're not willing to participate, but why do you think that's so? What's your assessment, Elaine?
Well, look, I mean, I met with the Philippine National Police a few days ago, and they said the same thing to me, that there is, you know, an unwillingness of families to come forward. But frankly, when you've seen your loved one, you know, gunned down, when you face intimidation from the police, you know, of course, you know, you will only do so if there is effective witness and victim protection. And that doesn't exist here. And we know from, you know, numerous cases that have also been, you know, investigated by civil society organizations that have, you know, shown the extent to which there's been very shoddy police work that has really been designed to cover up the involvement of the police in these killings. Then, you know, why would families participate in investigations that are purely going to be a cover-up? I mean, there needs to be some kind of independent international investigation. And the Philippine government has thwarted that at every turn. I mean, there were efforts at the Human Rights Council to try and hold the Philippine government to account. Mm-hmm. In the end, what we have is, you know, a joint program that is largely focused on, you know, building the capacity of the police. But frankly, you know, what will really send a message that these killings aren't tolerated is if we actually see accountability. And that means holding the perpetrators of these abuses to account and convicting the police officers that have been involved in these crimes.
If that is the case, and if that's your assessment, shouldn't it also be part of the equation that these families and those who are victims of this drug war file a case, for example, against former President Rodrigo Duterte, if they are telling the ICC that he is ultimately the one responsible for these atrocities?
Well, I think the victims and the families should be coming forward to file cases, but I think they need to know that they will be protected and that they won't face intimidation, harassment, and themselves then become a target. And, you know, unfortunately, what we've seen under the Marcos administration is actually an increase in extrajudicial killings, political related killings. And so, you know, I think it's really important that there is, some kind of effective victim protection, but also, you know, real independence. And I think that's what, you know, we want to see. You know, we met with the police, but, you know, frankly, you know, we're not convinced that they are taking these investigations seriously. And, you know, we've been here before. Extrajudicial killings have a very long history in the Philippines. And I think when you have a former president that has effectively given the green light to police to go after certain people living in the slums, people who supposedly, you know, have been engaged in drug activity, it gives a license to the police to kill drug suspects. Mm. And that's been the problem here. And that's why we've had thousands of killings and why there needs to be genuine accountability for this, which is why the Philippine government should extend its cooperation with the International Criminal Court.
I want to go now into the argument of the Philippine government that this is an affront to the sovereignty of the nation. You know, Elaine, a fundamental right is to be able to chart your own course. How is this not infringing on the sovereignty of the Philippines when the ICC is insisting that it has jurisdiction over the Philippines when the Philippine government says it does not?
Well, the Philippine government signed up to the Rome Statute. And so, you know, that comes with obligations to be, you know, held accountable for the crimes that were committed during the period of time that the Philippine government was a member of the Rome Statute. And the ICC has a principle of complementarity. And what that really means is that, you know, where a country is unwilling or unable to investigate and prosecute grave crimes, these are the most serious crimes, crimes against humanity, war crimes, and genocide, then the ICC will step in as a court of last resort. And that's what we're seeing in this case. We are certainly seeing an unwillingness of the Philippine government, despite, you know, the masses of evidence that have been produced from human rights organizations, from journalists, about the extent of the killings, from the UN, indeed, which issued its own report documenting these killings. There has been only a handful of prosecutions. So, you know, that's the reality. And I mean, the Philippine government can, you know, say what it likes at, you know, at the summit of democracy about its willingness to fight impunity. But, you know, we should measure the Philippine government on the actions. And, you know, the actions in terms of the numbers of convictions are far too low. You know, we've only seen two successful convictions for the thousands of cases. That is unacceptable. And that is why the International Criminal Court should proceed with its investigation.
I want to get your thoughts on what has been said by a former foreign secretary and also by the Solicitor General that, you know, questioning this very idea that what has happened is a crime against humanity when in fact it was a war against a crime that was happening then.
Well, I mean, you know, criminal suspects should be held to account for their actions. They should be investigated. They should be prosecuted in a court of law. They should not be shot dead. And, you know, that's the problem of what happened is that there was complete impunity for the police for these killings. And, you know, there have been just heartbreaking stories of people who've been in the wrong place at the wrong time, who've talked about having drugs planted on them, weapons planted on them. You know, we ourselves have done our own investigations, which have shown the extent to which police reports conflict the accounts of witnesses, of family members who are present, you know, during these drug raids. And so, you know, I think this is, you know, the fact is that even people in the Philippines who have tried to hold the Duterte administration to account have paid a very heavy price for that. I mean, earlier this week, I met with former Senator Leyla de Lima. She's been in prison now for more than 6 years. She hasn't been convicted of any crime, but, you know, she is paying a very heavy price for her opposition to the drug war. So I think the longer that you see, you know, members of civil society, a former justice minister, sitting in police detention because of her opposition and her attempts to hold the Philippine government to account. I mean, I think that tells you everything you need to know about how committed the Marcos administration is to addressing the killings in the war on drugs.
What do you think should be done at this point? I mean, of course, the ICC issue, that's one aspect of the fight for rights, right? And the rights situation here in the Philippines. What is your assessment of how this current administration is upholding human rights here in the country as we speak?
Well, I think, you know, we see the Marcos administration saying a lot of the right things at the international level. We know that the Philippine government is quite keen to, you know, make a bid for a seat at the UN Security Council. But frankly, I mean, if you want a seat at the table at the UN's highest body, then you also need to cooperate, you know, with international mechanisms like the International Criminal Court. It is part of being, you know, a good international actor. And, you know, we want the Philippine government to live up to, you know, its obligations as, you know, a democracy in the region. We want the Philippine government to be supporting free media and free civil society. But that also means that, you know, the cases against Rapla, against Maria Ressa, cases against de Lima, you know, these are cases that have been brought by the previous administration in order to really stifle any criticism of the drug war. So we'd really like to see from the Marcos administration a genuine attempt to address these issues. And, you know, it's been quite disappointing that we haven't been able to meet the Secretary of Justice or the Secretary of Foreign Affairs to discuss these issues here, because we want to have a dialogue with the Philippine government about these issues. And, you know, frankly, I think, you know, they're more engaged in, you know, trying to sort of say that they're doing the right things than actually putting the energy into taking the actions that will show that they are committed to defending human rights.
The reaffirming it's an unwavering commitment to uphold and strengthen democracy, endorsing the U.S. Summit for Democracy Declaration, is that, and yet trying to distance itself from the ICC, is that something that strikes you as genuine coming from this government?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I mean, it's engaging in double talk. It is duplicitous to say on the one hand that we are going to uphold the principles of democracy and then at the same time say that, you know, our commitment to fighting impunity means that the ICC shut out. I mean, I think, you know, the Philippine government cannot continue to engage in this kind of double talk on human rights. It can't say that it's upholding international law and universal values, but at the same time simply just reject the accountability of the International Criminal Court. So, you know, I think it's really important that if the Marcos administration is serious and is committed to fighting impunity and to protecting human rights, then it really should extend its cooperation to the ICC and let this investigation, you know, play out its course.
In the whole of Asia, though, of course, you're here, you're visiting as Asia Director for Human Rights Watch. In the whole of Asia, though, what is your assessment of the rights situation currently happening? In recent years, you've got the rise of authoritarianism and how that affects democracy and affects the rights situation in various countries. But as things stand now, your assessment, please.
Yeah, I mean, certainly across the region, we have a lot of challenges for human rights. I mean, we have the Chinese government also implicated in crimes against humanity against the Uyghurs in Xinjiang. And we saw a really damning UN report on that issue that came out last year. We're really concerned about the sort of sliding setbacks for democracy across Southeast Asia. So, you know, particularly in countries like Myanmar, you know, the NLD, the National League for Democracy, was recently disqualified from participating in upcoming elections. I mean, those elections are going to be an absolute sham. It is all about entrenching military rule. And we're seeing sort of similar types of tactics play out in Cambodia, in Thailand, where there are efforts to disqualify genuine opposition candidates. Mm. So, you know, I think as far as the Philippines is concerned, we are really concerned that crimes against humanity have been committed here under the previous administration. We're also concerned that there are continued extrajudicial killings. We're concerned about the red tagging of activists, lawyers, and others, which, you know, effectively paints a target on their back. And makes them very vulnerable. And, you know, in numerous cases, we have documented how environmental defenders or human rights lawyers have wound up dead after being red tagged. So I think, you know, every country has its own unique challenges in this region, but, you know, we're really looking to the countries that are democracies, like the Philippines, to really safeguard democracy. And that means that, you know, there needs to be strong institutions here that actually do hold the perpetrators of human rights violations to account. And, you know, certainly I think that the victims of the drug war, the thousands of families who are still feeling the pain every day of losing their loved ones, they deserve better. You know, they want to have some kind of accounting and recognition of what has happened to them. And so I think the International Criminal Court investigation is certainly a very important part of that.
And as we close this conversation, we talked to you about how we're, you know, having this conversation a day before Women's Month ends. And I want to shine the spotlight now on the rights situation of women and girl children all across Asia. Where does it stand as we speak, and what kind of a future, or what does the future hold for the women and girl children in all of Asia? Elaine.
Yeah, well, I mean, I also didn't mention Afghanistan when I gave my roundup of the region. But, you know, Afghanistan is the one country where we're seeing women and girls, they can't go to school anymore past grade six. We're seeing women not even being allowed to work for NGOs, not allowed to work in certain government occupations. And this is a real travesty for women's rights. So, you know, I think as this month rounds up, you know, we really need to, you know, celebrate human rights defenders, women human rights defenders who are on the front lines of safeguarding our rights. And here in the Philippines, you know, I immediately think of Leyla de Lima and everything that she has suffered, but how, despite the fact that she's in detention right now for 6 years, she continues to advocate strongly for human rights. And, you know, I think we should all take an example for that. And that, you know, wherever women's rights are being marginalized, wherever women are facing discrimination and violence, we need to be calling on our governments to be addressing those issues. And certainly we have a lot of challenges, you know, that we're facing here in Asia on that front.
Elaine Pearson there, Asia Director for Human Rights Watch. A pleasure talking to you, Elaine. Thanks for joining us today. Good afternoon.
Thanks for having me.